Hello, my name is Tom Barnes. Welcome back to our series of films dedicated to the future of British forests, woodlands and trees. These films are where I try and balance my deep despair at the declining state of our woodlands with, I hope, a healthy dose of optimism that trees and land use more widely have risen to the top of the political agenda. In our last film, we identified the fact that 40% of the trees in this country are based in small woodlands, and how important it is to recognise and understand the issues facing owners of these woodlands. For this episode, we are going to widen our focus and explore options for land that is not currently forested. We're going to have a look at agriculture and how farms can contribute to increasing and improving woodland cover in the UK. Currently, agriculture makes up about 70% of the land use in the UK, and only about 5% of this is woodland cover. Now, therefore, if we are going to meet government targets, then a lot of this is going to have to happen on agricultural land. Currently, in the UK, agriculture, the growing of food, and forestry, the growing and harvesting of trees, are treated as separate disciplines. Now, this may be partly cultural, but I do believe that this siloed approach has been reinforced by the Common Agricultural Policy, which has for years disincentivised the planting of trees on productive agricultural land. However, there is a way to farm that involves food production and increased tree cover, and that is agroforestry. This concept promises many environmental and ecological benefits. Now, agriculture is definitely not my area of expertise, so I've come to meet two people who have literary, academic, and practical experience of agroforestry. Chris Smaje, author of Small Farm Future, and his wife Cordelia Rowlatt, moved into farming in 2003. I've come to their farm near Frome in Somerset to find out why they got into farming and how trees have helped transform their land. Why do you think that trees are important in the agricultural landscape?
Well, they've got so many different functions. Some of them are fairly obvious ones. Obviously, they have uses as timber or livestock fodder. Trees, they do all sorts of things with water management and protection from flooding. And, you know, we've got a little bit away from that but in recent times, but historically, people always integrated trees with farming. Traditional land use was wood pasture, where people would graze animals underneath trees and make use of the products from the trees as well. I think that's going to be a bigger feature of farming again in the future.
Tell us the history of your involvement at Vallis and how you became interested in farming.
I guess it all originated from the idea of rethinking and relocalising the food system and sort of bringing people and food and local farming together, in ways that the mainstream food system doesn't do so much. My wife Cordelia and I, we were living in London. This was in the 90s, and people were talking about climate change and food and, you know, being the global food system being problematic and so on. We wanted to be near a town and part of a community, and we ended up buying this piece of land. The first thing we did actually was plant these trees.
These trees were all planted over kind of the winters of 2004 and 2005.
But then we started a market garden and a veg box scheme, and that's been the sort of main agricultural focus here, but various other community and education projects and kind of small holding activities.
Here, this is shared earth learning, the polytunnel over there, and also some of the land here. And they are an educational cooperative who provide opportunities for kids who benefit from being outside. It's fantastic to share land with groups like that, and also they get to use the woodland.
What does agroforestry mean to you, and how has it influenced the way you farm your land?
Well, I suppose really it just means sort of what it says on the tin. It's agriculture and forestry, and it's bringing those two things together. So, you know, we haven't necessarily thought of this as explicitly as an agroforestry project. It's more been a case of thinking about what sorts of land use we want to have, and it's been a little bit seat of a pants. We have sat down and planned things, but it's in some ways it's been a sort of reactive process.
One of the things we were trying to think about when we were planting trees is how we can use the space really effectively. And so we have a campsite where each pitch is a little bit separate. So, and people really love it because they're not squeezed together in a field.
I mean, one thing on this site is that it's quite wind exposed. We get these brutal southwesterlies ripping down from the Mendip. So if you look at the way we've planted trees, you'll see our paranoia about the southwesterly winds.
You can see this one. This is a sweet chestnut. It's quite old and it's tiny because it's getting blasted by the wind. But if we walk deeper this way, the ones at the front are providing wind shelter for the ones behind, and they're way bigger back here. I mean, this one actually is a cherry, not a sweet chestnut, but even the oaks back here are way bigger.
Pretty much the first trees we planted here, we interplanted hazel with alder, and so the idea was that the hazel with a sort of bushy lower growth habit would mix well with the taller growth habit of the alder and provide wind protection from top to bottom.
This is the main bit of the market garden, the intensive bit, where in the summer there's things that need picking, you know, kind of pretty almost every day.
And then of course they've got, both of those trees have got other functions. The hazel hopefully gives you some nuts, and the alder is a nitrogen fixing plant. We've got hazels or even oak, you know, we don't necessarily use it for our daily meals, but you know, there's a lot of it is about sort of multiplying functions and having a multifunctional site.
We planted about somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 trees initially. And one of the things we were really keen to be getting some crops from some of them. So chestnuts was a really prime one. And I love the idea of having chestnuts because you're getting a carbohydrate crop.
You know, it creates different spaces and creates some privacy in the site.
And we also were trying to create different spaces that would add different layers for biodiversity, but also different kind of human-sized spaces for things to happen. And as we walk around our land, it's quite interesting to see the effect that has, because as a human walking through our landscape, it feels really different to the kind of traditionally big agriculture scale of things. And that field is actually a similar size to us, and then as you walk all over us, it's like you can get lost in it.
We're using the timber, we heat our houses and hot water with it. We don't have any livestock at the moment for various reasons, but we have, like, right where we're sitting here, we've had like sheep grazing around in here, and obviously there's trees can provide fodder for livestock, and certainly in some of the hot summers we've had a couple of years back, that was quite significant actually.
Those trees are specifically ones where you can feed the leaves to the animals, and when it was really, really dry and the sheep were in there, my husband would go around and hack some of the branches off and drop them down for the sheep to eat.
Yeah. So there's a whole bunch of different things, and some of them are sort of more intensive, like we do have a little nut and fruit orchard. You lavish lots of care and attention on those trees, whereas some of the other ones, you know, you sort of pretty much plant them and let them do their thing. We've got some willow down at the bottom, which is fast growing. I mean, we use it mostly for firewood, and it helps take up some of the water in a sort of wet part of the site.
Considering that over 70% of the land in the UK is under agriculture, do you think that an agroforestry approach could help to meet government tree planting targets?
Yeah, I mean, I think what's attractive about that is that it's people thinking about trees, you know, putting trees to work sort of in the landscape and combining it with agriculture. You know, I think planting more trees is great, but people can, you know, you can get into this slightly sort of haphazard tree planting, and you know, there's a whole debate about climate change, and you know, should we really be planting trees to mitigate climate, or shouldn't we be looking more at fossil fuel use? But I think if you look at tree planting from an agroforestry lens, it's sort of like the pieces of the jigsaw come together, and it totally makes sense to plant trees, you know, as part of a wider land management. That's, you know, I think the result would that there would be more trees in the landscape, and they'd be delivering those multiple benefits.
Why now? What's changing that makes now the time for an agroforestry revolution?
Well, I mean, obviously there's sort of bigger things going on in the political landscape, like Brexit. So we're rethinking, you know, the whole policy framework of farming. Climate change is rising up the agenda. And I think, you know, there's the whole rewilding movement and people getting more interested in thinking about wildlife and interacting with wildlife in their local spaces. So it's a great time to be thinking about this and integrating trees. I mean, my concern, I guess, is we've got to keep thinking about food as well. You know, it's not just trees and it's not just wildlife or climate change. You know, it's about producing food for ourselves locally, and that's where agroforestry again contributes, because there's the agro bit as well as the forestry.
Are you enthused by the idea of the incoming ELMS policy and the shift in focus to the provision of public good?
I mean, I'm enthused by it relative to the last subsidy, which was paying people for owning land, essentially. So, yeah, I mean, public money for public goods makes sense. My worry is that it's going to push people into doing, you know, good things in terms of trees in the landscape and biodiversity stuff. But we need to be thinking about local food production and, you know, putting all these different parts of the economy together so that good, well-produced local food is available and affordable for everybody. So, you know, the ELM stuff is maybe one part of that that's pushing in the right direction.
What are your hopes and fears for the future of agroforestry and UK farming more widely?
Well, I suppose a fear is obviously it's a time of huge change, and the farm workforce is quite an ageing one. I think a lot of people will be perhaps thinking about getting out of farming, and the danger there is that we, you know, food production will diminish, and the government will perhaps be thinking more in terms of trade deals and importing food from other countries. And really what we need to be doing is relocalising food and producing more of it ourselves, sort of integrating it better in the landscape. But a hope is that, the policy framework is more geared to thoughtful integration of trees and biodiversity into the landscape. There's a lot of young people who are more switched on than perhaps even a few years ago.
If you could suggest one policy that the government could implement to support the work you're doing here, what would that be?
I'd probably say a carbon tax, because so much of the way, so many of the problems that we have are connected with cheap fossil energy that makes it easy to sort of divide land uses up into kind of single monocultural sorts of things. I mean, there's loads of other reasons why a carbon tax would make sense, but it would really incentivize people to be producing food and other products such as woodland products locally in the landscape in a way that's not really happening at the moment when fossil energy is so cheap.
Well, Cordelia, it's been fascinating to find out more about your land and how you've used the trees and interspersed the trees with your other types of agriculture. Remiss of me not to to introduce the book. This is Chris's book, Small Farm Future, and I would recommend that all of our viewers run out and buy a copy of this. It's got some real insights into small-scale farming and agroforestry. It's been fascinating to get a personal perspective from Chris and Cordelia and to understand the journey they've been on. Trees have completely transformed this landscape. You wouldn't believe that less than 20 years ago, this whole area was just bare arable fields. Vallis is evidence, I think, that trees can play a part in agriculture. So one question is whether agroforestry can contribute in a meaningful way to government targets for tree planting. Well, I would say it has to, because if agricultural land takes up 70% of our UK land area, we simply won't have enough space if we don't plant trees on farmland. So that's it for our visit to Vallis. The next episode, we tackle growing better trees for more productive and healthy woodlands. So thank you for watching, and please subscribe to our channel to see more of these films. Thank you.